Okay, assuming that you have completed the basic training of MQTT using Bricks DLC, let's do a very simple example using Do More Designer and the Bricks DLC. The first thing you must have is the correct hardware. There are many models of the Bricks DLC, but only those with a built-in Ethernet port, like this, will work. These PLCs have an E in their part number, as shown down here. The next thing is you have to configure your IP address. Now, I'm already connected to my Bricks PLC through the Ethernet port, so this I have already done. But you must configure this port first. So if I click here and go to Edit IP Configuration, you have module ID, name, and description. These are not necessary settings for the MQTT to work. Of course, you have the IP address, the subnet mask, and the gateway address. And you also have the DNS address. This is required if you're going to use your broker's name or its URL instead of its raw IP address. Then I would OK this, and I would write this down to the PLC. The next step is I must create an MQTT device. This is not created by default, so I would go to the system configuration here, and I would normally go to device configuration and press new device and MQTT client. But I've already done that, and mine is called MyMQTT. So let's take a look at those settings. If I double click here, this is the name I gave it, and this is the case I was telling you about previously, that if I'm going to use the server name, which here mine is called broker.hivemq.com, then I would have to have a DNS server. I would have to have that present and configured properly in my IP settings. Otherwise, I could use the raw IP address here. Now, the protocol here is MQTT, or I could use the encryption with MQTTS. And 1883 is the server port, the default port. This is the keep alive time of 30 seconds. That's default. And the quality of service is 0. I could pick also 1. I can't pick 2. The session type is clean or persistent. And then here, some MQTT brokers require a login before you can use them. So here's where I would pick that and set it. Mine doesn't require that. This is the last will and testament, where I would give that last will and testament a name and then what the data is and whether or not to retain it. And this is the enable user specified client ID. This is a 64-byte ID that's unique for each client that connects to the MQTT broker. Now, the Bricks PLC will create one for you using its MAC address. But you can assign your own if you wanted to by clicking this. And then, of course, I would OK out of these, just like so, and I would also write that down to the PLC. Next, after I have configured the PLC, I actually went and wrote a program. It's very simple. Go here to main, and you can see I have just a few C bits, and I'm basically going to just initialize R100 and R101 to some values. And then I'm going to use the MQTT pub instruction to publish those values to the broker. And then I'm going to use the MQTT sub instruction to read those back and store them in R200 and 201. So after I execute this, the values that are in R100 and 101 will end up in R200 and 201. And they will be continually updated as I am subscribed to those values. So now let's look at the MQTT pub instruction. Double click on him, you notice here I picked my MQTT client device, which mine is called MyMQTT. And I have a choice here of how to enable it, whether once on a leading edge, which basically if you have that and when you enable it, then it will just go through this list of published topics once and determine success or error. But I could also publish it continually. So here you can see I have continuous on power flow at interval. And I selected 1 second as the constant, or the time between when I publish. And basically what that is, as long as this input is on, then it will go through this list every second and try to publish these values. Now there's also another setting that's going to come into play, which I'll show you in just a second. Now also here is the optional topic prefix. I can put this, let's say that these topics here have a longer topic name, you know. Sometimes topics do. Like, say, Greg Test slash is actually prepended to this. So rather than having to type it in each time down here, I could choose this. But that also comes into play in another setting. I'll show you in just a second. So normally I would use the insert button to put in a new topic, but here I put in two topics. I've called one My R100 and My R101, and it's pointing to these elements in the memory of the Bricks PLC. You also see that these are set to retain. And here's the other thing, the publish is to publish this value on change. So what this means is, in the way that I have this set up, every second it's going to go down through here and see, has R100 its value changed since the last second that I looked at it? If it has changed, then publish it. If it has not changed, then don't publish it. Don't waste time out on the wire, in other words, if it hasn't changed. There's no need to republish the value. So what this looks like is very simple. Here you can see I could use the common optional topic prefix as well if I wanted to here or not. That means if I have this checked, then this optional topic prefix would come into play. If it's unchecked, then not. So that way I could have topics down through here that use this optional topic prefix and some that do not. So here I called it my R100 and I gave it, told it to send the value that's stored in R100. I told it to retain. And then also here I have the publish interval setting. And this tells you how, this is the setting right over here in this column. Publish at an interval only if the value changed since the last interval, or publish at every interval even if the value has not changed. That should be clear enough. So I made these two topics here to publish. Now also, of course, you have the on success and on error behavior. In this case, I'm choosing to just set some bits. Probably normally I would use stages to do this. And then there's also the extended error information that can be stored in a double word, D10. Now the thing about this is that the lower part of this word will contain an error code if it fails, and the upper word will contain a topic number of the first topic that failed. Say you had a list here of 10 things and maybe 5 of them failed, it would only point to the first one. So as you can see over here in my data view that I have put up here, I divided D10, which is my extended information double word, into the lower word and the upper word so that we can see that. So what I'm going to do later is I'm going to generate an error so you can just see that happen. So that is the MQTT pub instruction. That's pretty straightforward and simple. Now let's look at the MQTT sub. It's very similar to the pub instruction. So here I picked the client device, same thing. Here I have the optional prefix as described before. Here I have topics. And so if I open this up, you can see that I added to subscribe to my R101 and my R100, just like I published them up here. But I'm going to store the payload that I get from them into R200 and R201. That's pretty straightforward and easy too. And then same kind of buttons, also same on success and on error. And extended information is also available, and I stored this one in D1 or D11. And you can see over here in my data view, I have D11 divided into the lower word and the upper word. And so basically the MQTT sub, as long as its input is on, it's going to be subscribed to these topics. If I ever turn it off, then it won't receive any more updates. But as long as I leave it on, then whenever this R100 up here changes, it should get reflected into R200, for example. So let's see how this works. First thing I'm going to do is put this guy in the run mode. But remember, whenever I configured my MQTT broker, I had a certain URL name. Let's go there and look at that real quick. You see I'm using broker.hivemq.com. That is the URL of the free one that I'm using that's out on the internet. I wouldn't recommend it for an actual application, but for demonstration, it's perfect. If you go to mqtt-dashboard.com, then you can see the dashboard for that particular broker. But you can see here that the broker's name, his broker, HiveMQ.com. That's what I put in as my broker. A TCP port number 1883, which was the default for MQTT. And so now let's just demonstrate this. I'm in the run mode and I initialize R100 and 101. Then I will publish. I have a success. And then I will subscribe. And so now you notice that R200 and R201 reflect the values that were up here. And if I happen to change them to something else and write that down, then you can see, because I'm subscribed to that value, then I get it back here in my data. Now, normally in the real world, a particular PLC might be publishing information and a different PLC would be subscribing to that information. You wouldn't be doing what I'm doing here. So this is just a demonstration, and that's how easy it is to use MQTT on a Brix PLC. To see how to troubleshoot MQTT in a Brix PLC, check out our MQTT troubleshooting video.